Everyone, welcome or welcome back to my channel. My name is Katie. I am doing a little series on like social commentary of like the human condition and things like that. And then a lot of also what I talk about on this channel is charity and ways to help people and try to be like a better person and kinder to the earth and things like that. So today's topic is going to be judging poor people. I only laughed because I need to think of a better title for the video. That's really not a good title. So I do have some notes on my phone, so I apologize if I'm looking down a little bit while I'm doing the video, but I just kind of want to try to stay on track. Sometimes when I just start talking, I just go all over the place. However, I may end up going all over the place anyway. Who knows? We'll see how this works out. Everyone knows that it's very difficult to stay away from social media. There are a few people who don't have social media accounts, but you still hear about social media on the news and other people talk to you about social media, and it is pretty much impossible to stay away from in some way, shape, or form at this point. People who may not have a Facebook account or an Instagram might still have a LinkedIn account, and that does count as social media. And there's this rise on social media of minimalism. And there are some people who are truly minimalist because that's just the way that they live. However, there are people who kind of fetishize, is that a word? Fetishization? Who kind of fetishize poor people? And I will explain what I mean about that in a minute. So think about a time that you couldn't have something but you wanted something. This last year with the pandemic has been a fantastic example. People were told not to go out to eat. People who normally didn't go out to eat suddenly were like, it's my right to go out and eat. And it just shows that when you tell someone that they can't do something, it makes them want it more. And if you've worked with toddlers or you have children, I mean, I'm sure people have seen this phenomenon, and it really isn't just related to children. Adults behave this way too. So there are some people who are forced to live on very low amounts of money. In every country in the world, there is poverty. Obviously, some countries have more incidences of poverty than others. And then in the United States, I can't speak about other countries, but I know in the United States there is this subset of people who don't quite qualify for assistance but can't quite pay all their bills, and they're kind of stuck here in this limbo. And so in this video, when I'm talking about poor people, I'm talking about people in limbo and then also the people who are on assistance. So there are a lot of people who fetishize or romanticize being poor. So there's a big uptick on social media, especially YouTube, about van life, and on TikTok. People living in vans, buying vans, refurbishing them, traveling around the country, and living in a van. There are some people for whom that is not a choice. They have to live in a van. They have nowhere else to live. And the people who are doing these van life videos are making them, building them up so nice that it's like nicer than my house. They're putting so much money into their van. So they're saying, I live in a van, and which technically, if you don't have a permanent address, you are technically considered homeless. So homeless isn't just people who sleep on the streets. Homeless is people who don't have a permanent address. So a lot of people in the United States who are homeless are people who are kind of like couch surfing between friends' houses because they don't have their own apartment or a place or, you know, room to stay in on a permanent basis. They're staying 3 months with that friend, a year with that friend, 2 months with that family member. They are still considered homeless, and they factor in to our statistics. So these people who are living the van life by choice, in my opinion, they're not true homeless because for them, it was a choice. And I mean, I can kind of see the appeal of getting away from corporate America and just traveling and living off the grid and being free, but at the same time, they are also promoting this like minimalist, pseudo faux poor lifestyle and saying that it's a great lifestyle to have. So what this does is it makes other people look at poor people and be like, hey, well, these people are choosing to live in their van, so you're living in a van, so like, what are you complaining about? These people make it look great. And the truth is, these people who are making it look great are not the same as these people who are forced to live in a van. There are also people who pretend to live on low amounts of money. I mean, there are obviously like challenges that people do, and I don't see a problem with them as long as you are doing it to learn or gain value from it. For example, I've seen like live on the food portions that a refugee has. So they get a bag of rice, they get some beans, they get this, they get that. And I think if you do it and you want to document it or you don't want to document it, but if you gain something from it, you're more learning, more understanding, more compassion, then that's great. Living, you know, on food bank rations or living on food stamp rations, SNAP rations in the United States, but it's a choice that you have. So when people are watching other videos or, you know, hearing about people living on a dollar a day, and then they hear about people who have to live on a dollar a day, it's very different. Because the thing is, if you live on a dollar a day for a month, or you live on food stamp rations for a week, in your head, you know at the end of it that you can be done and you can go back to your normal life. But for those people, there is no end in sight. So take, for example, maybe a job that you hate. I only laugh because this is a position that I'm like kind of in. But if it's an internship and you have a really crappy internship for 6 months, in your head, you can tell yourself, okay, just have to deal with this for 6 months, my life's just gonna suck for 6 months, and then it's over. But say you have a job that you really don't like, it is very difficult to wrap your head around the fact that I have to do this for the next 35 years. There is no end in sight. So that's the difference between people who kind of romanticize aspects of poverty versus actually living in poverty. And companies also try to profit off of this. Think the dirty jeans from Urban Outfitters, I will try to insert photo, that sold a couple years ago for a couple $100s. Basically, they just got jeans like really, really dirty, and then people would buy a couple $100s to put them on and walk around and look like they did a hard week's, a hard day's worth of physical work when they didn't. And then people who only own super dirty jeans because they do physical farming work or whatever, construction labor work, that's all they have. They don't have a choice to put on a clean pair of clothes tomorrow, but this person just spent $500 or whatever on a pair of jeans to make it look like they did a hard day's of work. Hard day worth of work. An honest day's work, whatever that phrase is. And then you also see this with the starving artist or the broke college student. A lot of the artists are not starving. A lot of the college students are not actually broke. There's a lot of people who just say that they're broke when they're not. I have been guilty of this. Basically, what I do is I shovel money away into savings and I do not touch it. As far as I'm concerned, that money does not exist. However, that's the only reason I was able to buy a house, because I did that. But when people say I am broke, but you have money in a savings account, you have a safety net. People who are truly broke don't have a safety net. It is not cool to go around saying that you can't afford something and then you go buy yourself a new outfit and a pack of cigarettes and a bottle of wine, because that's like $50 that you just spent. And people who are truly broke don't have $50 to go drop on cigarettes and wine. There's also like the college students who say that they're poor. And yeah, so there's a lot of people who are like, well, I'm poor, but my parents have money. I don't have my parents' money. The thing is, like, they kind of do. If their parents are paying for college, they're coming out of college with $0 of debt versus someone coming out of college with $200,000 of debt. You're not broke, really. You're not, you know what I mean? It's almost like it's cool to say that you're poor or broke, or I don't know. It's kind of weird. And then there are people who get inheritances while at the same time saying they're broke. Even like, if I know, I'm not getting any inheritances, but if I were to know that I was getting an inheritance, that would be very different than how I live my life now, I think, really being careful. because I know I don't have a safety net coming to me at any point in time. I'm not even poor. But when you take someone who's really struggling and they're struggling and they know that there's no end in sight, they can't even look forward to an inheritance. I mean, as awful as it is, like, you have to lose someone in order for that inheritance to come to you. Like, that's awful. But you also, like, do gain a little bit of ease in your life, at least financially. And I know people say money can't buy happiness, but money can totally buy happiness. And there's actually been more recent studies done. So originally there were some studies done saying that your happiness level kind of tips off at like $100,000 a year of earnings. People who earn like 100 and 200, and it's kind of like all the same after that. But there have been even more recent studies saying that happiness continues at every dollar, every extra money that you earn. So money does buy happiness. So I think a better way to phrase it is money is not the be all and end all, but to tell poor people that money is not gonna solve their problems is really disingenuous. They don't wanna hear that you have problems. Oh my God, having money is so stressful. I have to decide, I have so many decisions to make. They don't want to hear that. And then I think also Americans almost want to think of themselves as poor, so that when they accomplish something, they can look at it and be like, I earned that. I did that all by myself. But actually, you didn't do that all by yourself. And Obama, actually, when he was running for his first presidency term, I believe, made some sort of comment to the effect of, nobody has gotten to where they are solely by themselves. Nobody.
Somebody helped to create this unbelievable American system that we had that allowed you to thrive. Somebody invested in roads and bridges. If you got a business, that you didn't build that. Somebody else made that happen. The internet didn't get invented on its own. Government research created the internet, so then all the companies could make money off the internet.
You've had a teacher, you've had a mentor, you've had one interaction with somebody at some point in your life. Like, zero people have gotten to where they are. You've had maybe an inheritance, maybe based on where you were born or the family you were born into or the color of your skin or an activity you participated in, or basically nobody has gotten to where they are based on themselves and themselves alone.
If you've been successful, you didn't get there on your own.
And his people, his handlers, told him to like stop saying that, because that does not go over well with American people. Even though it's very well and true, that was gonna be a really bad soundbite for him. So he kind of dropped that whole thing. There are a lot of people who have luck and privilege and don't realize it. It's so hard not to get into political topics, and it's so funny that like things are politicized that shouldn't be politicized. But I'm just gonna list some privileges that I have. I am white. I am not hopeless looking. I am not large. I participated in gymnastics. I went to school. I had some good teachers. I had the ability to do my homework and not go to work. I was able to get jobs kind of when I wanted to get jobs. I have clean clothes. I've always had clean drinking water. I have always had enough food. I've had enough of the right kinds of food so that I could be healthy. I have always had access to a doctor. I've been able to go to a doctor literally anytime I wanted to. I've been able to get my teeth taken care of anytime I wanted to. I have had access to the internet so that I could do any homework that I needed or look up anything that I needed. I had adequate heating in my house. I had adequate cooling in my house. I had a place to live with a roof over my head. I've never been homeless. I'm sure I can think of more, but that was just off the top of my head. And so the thing is, like, just because you have luck and you have privilege doesn't mean that your life hasn't been hard. Because on the flip side, my mom had me in high school. My mom was a single mom. She got her first apartment with me when I was 3. She always was stressed about finding me babysitters. She had to work at night. She had to work during the day and then go to school at night so she could continue her education. So therefore, I didn't have, you know, as much interaction with my parents as other people do. I mean, so just because I had all of those privileges doesn't mean you had zero struggles. It just means that the struggles that you had could have been even worse if you added those other things into it, if that makes sense. So basically, when something is a choice, it's a choice. It's a choice to live in a van. It's a choice to not spend a lot of money. It's a choice to save some money. It's a choice to buy a bottle of wine. So when you have choices, it doesn't mean it should be forced on somebody else. Just because you choose to live in a van doesn't mean that living in a van is sufficient. And everyone, you know, and also like with the United States and your whole, and people thinking that they earned everything that they have by themselves and with nobody else's help, I think kind of ties into everyone believes that they are one in a billion, and not everyone is one in a billion. So like, you might see a news story about, I don't know, this kid walked 10 miles each way to work every day, went to school, cared for his mom, and ended up with a law degree or whatever. And the thing is, the reason the news covers that is because it's an exception. If that were a common thing that everyone was able to accomplish physically, mentally, emotionally, then it wouldn't be a news story. So when you see something on the news like that, you shouldn't compare everyone to that news story. You shouldn't be like, oh, well, those poor people are fine because like that one kid on the news went to Harvard Law while working and taking care of his mom and whatever, because that's just such a big exception. So that's my rant on why you should not judge people who are pretending to be poor, and be sure to give this a thumbs up, subscribe, and leave a comment.